Good morning, all of you. In the last lecture, we have talked about first order system. In the framework of dynamic, I mean, we are here to seek the dynamic response of the system. And in the last lecture, we have seen the dynamic response of the first order system, in which we have gone through natural and forced responses, and we have seen that how the solutions are seek in the framework of natural and forced responses, and we have also talked about the characteristic of the system in the form of time constant. In this lecture, we are going to talk about the second order system. In second order system, the highest order of the dependent variable is 2. A typical, if you talk about typical second order system, let's suppose we have a spring and a damper system. In the following form, this is mass m, this is k spring constant with damping constant c. So we have already obtained the governing mathematical model for this typical spring mass damper system. In the following way, m d2x by dt square plus c dx by dt plus kx is equal to the external forcing f, if at all the force f is being acted on the system. Now we are interested to look into the solution, basically how x is behaving with time. And we have also talked about that this particular form is a forced response form, so we can seek the solution with the method of natural response plus forced response individually. And then we are going to add the solutions obtained from both the responses. So natural response is nothing but the response of the homogeneous solution, right? And this is for particular solution. This comes from particular solution. We have already, you guys might have already studied this in your engineering mathematics in second year. How to seek the solution for these sort of governing equations. So let's take up first the natural response. In this form, so we can reformulate our problem in homogeneous form as follows: m d2x by d2x by dt square plus c dx by dt plus kx is equal to 0. Since this is a second order system, so it will be a bit of mathematics in order to get the natural response. So first, what I am going to do is I am going to divide this natural or homogeneous form of equation, and we will first seek the solution with no damping present. means c is equal to 0. So what is the purpose of doing this? With no damping present in the system, essentially you will get the natural frequency present in the system. Okay, how? So let's work out the mathematics here. So with no damping, the equation is in modified form can be written as m d2x by dt square plus kx is equal to 0, since c is equal to 0 here. This goes away. So let, for this particular solution, let my x, let us assume that the solution is of the form of some a sine omega t, which where a is some amplitude and omega is some frequency. If we input this solution, let the solution be of this type. Generally, second order differential equations are the solution of second order differential equations are seek in this fashion. When we input in this equation, we get two times differential, so minus a omega square sine omega t plus ka sine omega t is equal to 0. M is also there, so m omega square plus k is equal to 0, which will lead to this form, omega is equal to k by m underscore, or omega square is equal to k by m, and omega is equal to under root k by m. So this omega, what we seek is a modified, we got this omega because we are seeking the natural frequency present in the system. So this omega essentially is natural frequency, tells you about the natural frequency this system can have, this particular system can have. Now what we do, let's keep this in our hand. Let's suppose this is my equation 1. Now let's seek the whole equation. This is my m. Whole equation as m d2x by dt square plus c dx by dt plus kx is equal to 0. And this equation has all the damping terms and spring constants present in the system. And now let the solution be of following form: x is equal to some constant a e raised to the power some constant s times t. Generally, this exponential form satisfies this sort of equations with prescribed boundary condition. So what we can get here, dx by dt is equal to as e to the power st, and d2x by dt square is equal to as square e to the power st. Now we put these solutions here and we get the equation of following form: m as square e to the power st plus c as e to the power st plus a k e to the power st is equal to 0. These exponential terms will be non-zero, so we can get rid of these exponential forms, and we can, and also a's are common, so we can we are left with this form: ms square plus cs plus k is equal to 0. This equation is often called as auxiliary equation. Or sometimes also called characteristics equation. Characteristic equation. Here, since this is a quadratic equation, we can get the solution of this form: s is equal to minus c plus minus under root c square minus 4mk divided by 2m, or more elaborately we can write minus c 2 by m, sorry, minus c by 2m plus minus under root if we take k by m common, I can write it in this form: c square by 4mk minus k by m. So these under root k by m, or I can more precisely I can write k by m as omega square. We can substitute it here, right here and here. So we can write equation in this form: before doing that, we also assume that let my another coefficient known as zeta, damping factor, zeta is given as c by 2 under root m times k. We let that our damping factor, this is called damping factor. We let this damping factor be of this form: c is the ratio of c divided by 2 under root mk. So we can modify this s in the following form. So s we can write as minus zeta, this zeta, times omega n, your natural frequency, plus minus omega n under root zeta square minus 1. once you get this S, now your general solution can be, now a general solution can be general solution of this natural response, of the natural equation, natural form of equation can be written. Can be written based on zeta value. So zeta is greater than zero, greater than one. It undergoes overdamping case. Zeta equal to one and zeta less than one. So all these cases, individually, the general solution can be written for particular damping cases. The corresponding general solution can be written in the following form. So let's suppose we have case 1 is where zeta is greater than 1, and this case is called overdamped case. So what was my S form? So our S was, S is equal to minus zeta omega n plus minus omega n under root zeta square minus 1. So we can see that if at all zeta is greater than 1, zeta is greater than 1, the square root equation, I mean this S will be having two different roots. S1 and S2. So where S1 is equal to minus zeta omega n plus omega n under root zeta square minus 1, and S2 is equal to minus zeta omega n minus omega n under root zeta square minus 1. Right? So the general solution in this case can be written as x and t. My solution, it is written, since my solution is of this form and you get S as S1 and S2, it can be written in the following generic form: x and t is equal to e to the power S1t plus b e raised to the power s2t, where s1 and s2 are these, s1 and s2. You should substitute s1 and s2 here. We'll talk about graphically later how does this look like in a comparative way. The second case, case 2, where zeta, your damping factor, this is zeta, is the damping factor. It depends upon your material property. It depends upon K, C, K and M, right? So if your zeta is 1 for your system, so your S, this S, if zeta is equal to 1, this goes away. This goes away and you are left with minus zeta omega n. And also, since zeta is equal to 1, I can also I can write minus omega n, s is equal to minus omega. So your s1 is equal to s2 is equal to minus omega n, the natural response, natural frequency of the system. So the general solution in this form and this case is called critically damped case. And the general solution in this case is written as x and t is equal to a t plus b times e to the power s t or s 1 t or s 2 t. So we can again write a t plus b e raised to the power minus omega n times t. Right. Now let's talk about the case 3. Case 3 is where your zeta is less than 1. This is called underdamped case. So overdamped case means if zeta is greater than 1, your damping is, see what is my zeta? So zeta, we have written zeta is equal to c divided by 2mk under root. So it means c, your damping coefficient is higher in this case. So your case is overdamped. So your door dampers. Are often overdamped. So when you open the door, it doesn't oscillate. It is overdamped and it dissipates energy in some form without making a noise. It shuts your door with so ease that it doesn't oscillate to and fro, and it's not desirable also. So in this underdamped case is where C is lesser than your spring constant in some sense. So it means this form of system undergoes oscillations. So any springy system or any you are driving over a car, your things oscillate to and fro too much. So those examples fall under this case. So when zeta is less than 1, you have two complex roots. Okay, since this is lesser, you will have the plus minus high values. So let's see. What is my S1 and S2? So S I can write minus zeta omega n plus minus omega n under root zeta square minus 1, which again we can write minus zeta omega n plus minus omega n under root 1 minus zeta square times iota. Right, I can write that where I is equal to under root minus 1. So this we call another variable called omega d. Damping frequency is omega n under root 1 minus zeta square. So what we can write here is minus zeta omega n plus minus I omega d. So your S1 and S2 you can write S1 minus omega zeta omega n plus I omega d and s2 you can write minus zeta omega m minus I omega d. This is the way we write it here. We just substitute, we call this some new omega d value for the ease of writing, that's all. So this is a general form of equation in this type, in this underdamped case, can be written as a e raised to the power s1t plus b e raised to the power s2t. So in general we can write a e raised to the power minus zeta omega n plus I omega d times t plus b e raised to the power minus zeta omega n minus I omega d times t. Okay, let's look at graphically how does these solutions, how does this look like graphically with respect to time. So when we are going to plot the responses, the natural, all these are natural responses with respect to time, and we talk about xt here. So let's suppose this is my steady state solution. Since I mean we are yet to derive steady state solution, but for the time being we can have a graphical feel of physically how does this look like. So this underdamped case, if you give us a step response, okay, we didn't talk even right now. So let's for the time being let's talk about the step response first, and then we'll write about the overall solution here. So we'll talk about the overall solution. So the overall solution, x overall is nothing but x on, that is natural, plus s f, this is forced, this is natural. So we have already seeked this xn solution. We need to seek the xf solution now. So again it is kind of hit and trial. So for step type input, of size or magnitude f, try that xf is equal to some constant a, the constant. Okay, what is my general equation? We'll write it again. So this is m d2x by dt square plus c dxt by dt plus s kx is equal to f. Since xf is a solution, so this should satisfy this particular equation. So m d2xf by dt square plus c dxf by dt plus kxf is equal to f. And since this xf is a constant a, we will substitute it here. So since this is a constant, this goes away. Since this is a constant, this goes away. We are left with this. So we can write x, what is my xf? This is a, is equal to my forcing function f. So we can obtain the value of constant as f by k. and which is your xf. So this xf we will put it here, and we can write the overall solution, x overall solution is xn plus xf. So what is my xn? So let's suppose my my system, so xn you will seek from your back solutions, these are your xn's. So it will depend upon your property, material property, whatever the zeta you are getting, you will just pick these equations and substitute it here. So for the time being, let's suppose my system is having overdamped case. So for overdamped case, the natural solution is of this following form. So I can write a e to the power s1 t plus b e raised to the power s2 t plus xf. What is your xf? So xf will be f by k. This f by k is a particular solution just by assuming that we have a step input only. If you are having ramp input, if you are having sinusoidal input, the solution procedure will be different. So we just talked about the step type input. So this is your overall solution. One thing we can note it here, that when time tending to infinity, what happens with this solution? At infinity means at infinite time, steady time, when the things are getting steady or we are giving enough time to the system, these two goes away, these two coefficients goes away, so we are left with fk. So this f by k is essentially your steady state solution. Okay, now let's talk about graphically. We'll come back here and we'll talk about graphically how this solution represent. The underdamped, first we'll take the underdamped system. So you'll see that this system, if we are giving input, if my input is step, so your input is, if your input, let's suppose at t is equal to 0, you have given this much input, and you keep on giving this input. So this is your ft. With time, you are giving input t. So how your system will behave depending upon your parameter, and if at all your parameter is such a way that your system falls under underdamped case, so this will essentially goes from zero, it will shoot up, it will go down, it will do some oscillations, and then it may reach to a steady state after some time. So this is your underdamped case. You'll have oscillations. Okay, now let's talk about the critically damped case. So in this critically damped case, you will get the solution like this. It will achieve steady state without any oscillation. It's like door damper or some form of door damper. And this is your next is your overdamped case. So this is your critical damp. overdamped case will look something like this. It will have a set value, more set value than critically damped, and it will have more damping. So higher the zeta value, higher will be the damping here. Okay, now let's talk about some characteristics. Of second order system. So unlike first order system, we have time constants. We have several time constants, such as first one is delay time. Denoted as TD. Second one is rise time, denoted as TR. Third one is the peak time, denoted as TP. Another one is overshoot or maximum overshoot. As MP, and the last one is settling time. TS. So it will be more clear if you draw a graph over here. Your time coordinate, this is your response xt. Let's suppose you have given a step input, this is my step input, this is input I'm giving to the system. Value 1, so the delay time is characterized. So let's suppose you have an underdamped system, so you will have a response like this. So delay time is the time to reach this response 50%, let's suppose this is my 50% of the steady state. So this is your TD, this is known as TD. Okay, the next thing is the rise time. The rise time is the time required for response to rise from 10% to 90% of its final value. For underdamped case system, it is from 0 to 100% rise time is used. So this, in the case here, this is, since this is underdamped case system, so it is raising from, so time taken from 0 to the full full value, 100% value when it first time it has reached. It's called the rise time in the underdamped system. For overdamped system, it will never reach. So it will be characterized as the 90% of its value from 10%, so to say. Okay, now let's talk about the peak time. So the peak time is characterized by the peak value it has achieved. How much time it has taken to reach the peak value. This is your TP. Okay, now the maximum overshoot, this term is the value of how much it has gone far from the steady state. So this value is called MP. And MP, in percentage, the percentage MP is written as C TP minus C infinity divided by C infinity times 100. So this is the magnitude, this is the response at time TP minus C infinity, how much time it has taken at infinite time, what is the length of this, response, this minus this divided by this. So this is essentially called the maximum overshoot. So basically this MP is nothing but the maximum amplitude it has attained from unity. That is how it is defined. Now the settling time is the time required for the response curve to reach and stay within the range of about 2%. So let's suppose now it has reached between 2% of the steady state value. 2% to 5%. So till that time, let's suppose it is achieving at this moment of time. So this time is called settling time. So why these times are important? Because these times are essential to characterize the system. So let's suppose if it is having higher TD or delay time, so we can say that the system has is sluggish. It is not responding the system. It is not responding as per the input. If at all input is given, it is sluggish in nature. If at all it is higher value, and similarly all these things. So with this. That's it for this in this chapter. In the next chapter, we'll talk about the transfer function. So, transfer function is a tool through which we can analyze the system and to get the solution easily. Of these sort of systems. Thank you.